Welcome to Lutheranism in the United States. My name is Arthur Bergren. I serve as the lead pastor at St. Paul's Lutheran Church and School here in Waverly, Iowa. Last time we talked about the fullness of the Lutheran experience in the United States, how it existed with a time of breaking apart and coming together. Today we're going to talk about three Lutherans in America who have been so influential to our own day and age. Those names include Pastor Henry Muhlenberg, Pastor William Passavant, and Pastor Beth Plotz. We begin first with Pastor Muhlenberg. He was born in 1711 in Germany. He'd be educated there, and he'd become a pastor of the church in the year 1739. It was then when he was ordained. And if you don't know what an ordination service is, it's where a pastor is given the privilege of being able to preach God's word and minister the sacraments. And so it was that he was offered a three-point parish in America, and he accepted. And I think what that tells us about Muhlenberg very early on is this man had a spirit of adventure inside of him, the willingness to give up the knowns of Germany and to come to a different place shows his great, great spirit of adventure. He would set foot in Charleston, South Carolina in fall of September 1742. And it's really interesting to note that he immediately experienced the institution of slavery. And this is a direct quote from Muhlenberg. He said, "This is a horrible state of affairs, and it will entail a severe judgment." It is a prophetic word, because certainly we would see the horrific nature of the Civil War and then the enduring racism that has continued to plague this nation. Some historians have referred to slavery as America's original sin. We see it still very much alive and well in the Ahmaud Arbery case, where a young man who is jogging is literally shot to death, and then the people who engaged in the crime, no one will prosecute them for months on end. Muhlenberg saw the terrible realities of slavery. He's known for a motto, Ecclesia Plantata, which is "Let the church be planted." And I think this is really one of his major legacies. We're living in a day and age where we're going to have to replant the church. And I think that motto is one that all of us could really do well with. He would oversee growth in buildings. In the span of 5 years, he would open up and have buildings put up in Tuppenhagen, Providence, Germantown, New Hanover, Philadelphia. You know, I served a congregation, my first congregation, and it took us 4 years to go from a storefront church into a building, and to help be a part of that experience. It was amazing. But to do five in 5 years, completely blown away. He was a tireless worker. He also was somebody who organized the larger church as well. In 1748, he would organize the synod known as the Ministerium of Pennsylvania. And there was just a handful of people there, some lay delegates and Swedish and German pastors. They created that organization. They even authorized a hymnal, and it was an amazing experience. But he was very specific. He did not want a European extension of the church in America. He wanted its own American Lutheran church. Quoting Muhlenberg, he said of that synod, "A twisted cord of many threads will not easily break. There must be unity among us." And they would meet annually as the synod, which of course reminds us of our own synod assembly. He also saw, as the German immigrants would come in, and from the 1750s on, 12,000 would emigrate, and there needed to be more organization for the wider church. And so he would be somebody who would help oversee the establishment of 80-plus congregations in Pennsylvania. You'd see the expansion to five districts. And the New York Lutheran congregations got so big, they broke off and they formed their own synod. I think also the Muhlenberg family is something to be aware of as well. They provided service to our country. General John Muhlenberg was a Revolutionary War general. Frederick Muhlenberg would become the first Speaker of the House. And Henry Muhlenberg would be a scientist and college president. This is truly a family of amazing service. I like to go back to the motto, "Let the church be planted." I think this is such a good legacy. Next time, we're going to talk about what I'm seeing in terms of the decline and where we're going and some possible outcomes and futures for us. I think we're in a time where we're seeing the church becoming fragmented and being fractured for a variety of reasons. But it's also a time where we need to understand that we need to possess that same spirit of adventure that Muhlenberg did, and to replant the church, being open and being creative and being willing to do things differently. I think that legacy is going to be so important moving us ahead. Now, the next person that I want to introduce you to is also equally amazing, the Reverend William Alfred Passavant. He was actually born in Pennsylvania in 1821. He'd be educated at Jefferson College and then Gettysburg Theological Seminary. And Gettysburg Seminary still is around to this very day. It's now partnered with another seminary, but it's an amazing place. And as you know, it was the site of a Civil War battlefield. And there's still evidence of the war found on the grounds of Gettysburg Theological Seminary, but I digress. It's interesting to note that some American church historians refer to 1849 to 1893 as the Passavant era. He is somebody who had a huge, compassionate heart for those who were sick, for those who were in need. He established social services everywhere and for everyone, and really with lasting effects. Let me give you some examples. He would start a hospital in Pittsburgh in 1849. We now call that hospital the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center. In 1863, he would establish a hospital in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. That's now known as the Sinai Samaritan Medical Center. He'd establish a hospital in 1865 in Chicago, Illinois, and that's now known as Northwestern Memorial Hospital. Wherever you see a hospital that has the word Passavant in it, you know that he was directly related to it. He was also somebody who made sure there was numerous orphanages. After the Civil War, there were so many children that had no place to go. And he was somebody who made sure that those children were provided for. He also was someone who made sure that there were homes for those who had become older. It's the first generation of nursing homes, if you will. They called them homes for the aged. And he also made sure that the Protestant deaconesses were provided for as well. Here's some quotes from him showing that depth of compassion. The Lord will provide, he said. I'm going out to get some money and will be back for dinner. And he would return back to his home and he would say, the Lord has not sent us money, but he has sent us some of his people to be cared for. It was a man who was shaking with fever. He also spoke this word, the church is not merely a sheepfold, but a workshop. How necessary when death robs children of its natural protector that the church of the Redeemer should stand in its place. Just utterly amazing. And not dissimilar from Muhlenberg, he also became involved with organizing the widest denomination. He established the Pittsburgh Synod. He would also then become involved with Teal College, becoming a publisher and editor of their college paper. He would be a part of the General Council, and he would establish a seminary in Chicago known as Chicago Theological Seminary. By 1910, it became Maywood, and in 1967, it would become my alma mater, the Lutheran School of Theology at Chicago. He died on January 3rd, 1894, and the research I've showed is that this was a national story for the United States. His obituary appeared all across the nation as someone who did so much good for so many people, and how that good has lasted to our own day and age. I think the legacy for this man is that we are the second largest provider of non-governmental social services. And what we do in our social service networks is amazing. We provide for those who are most at need. But we also need to understand that this is also at risk. I'm most familiar with Illinois, but I'm learning a little bit about Iowa, and some of the same issues are true. States are defunding our social service network, and we can lose that great ministry if we don't have faithful partners in government. This is an important work. When we lose track of those who are most vulnerable, we are losing our own sense of the Christian faith and life. Remember, Jesus always had a deep and abiding concern for those who were at risk. And the church should have the same commitment and sensibilities. Always remember the Beatitudes. We need to be that for those people and to support them and to walk with them. So as we think about Muhlenberg, we move on to our third and final person, who is the Reverend Beth Platts. She is the first woman pastor of European descent ordained in North America. Like Passavant, a graduate of Gettysburg Theological Seminary. It was 1970, and the Lutheran Church women of the Lutheran Church in America had their annual convention, and they passed a resolution to memorialize the National Assembly, and it was to ordain women. And the resolution passed, and the American Lutheran Church also would pass the same resolution in their own tradition later in 1970. And what occurred is Elizabeth Platts would be ordained on November 22nd, 1970, and she would spend her career at Luther's Campus Ministry at the University of Maryland. I once spoke to her and asked her about her experience, and I don't for a second pretend to know her, but the impression that I walked away of her was that she was a person of great humility and kindness and decency. The closest comparable that I could come up with that I think all of you might know in the St. Paul's community is she reminds me of Pastor Joyce Sandberg, unassuming, deeply faithful, and loving of God's people. Her legacy is so profound. I'm going to share with you a series of names and remind all of us what this great opening did for the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. In 1979, Lydia Rivera Kalb is the first Latina woman ordained. In 1979, Erlyn Miller is the first woman of African descent ordained. January 22nd, 1990, Ruth Frost and Phyllis Zilhart are the first open members of the LGBTQ community ordained. But because of ELCA policies on same-gendered relationships in that day and age, the congregation that called them was sadly disciplined. St. Francis was suspended for 5 years, then the congregation was expelled in 1996. In 2010, Frost and Zilhart were formally received back into the ELCA after the 2009 changes in policy to welcome the LGBTQ community on the roster. 1992, April Larson is the first woman of European descent elected as a synodical bishop in the ELCA. At the time, she was the second person that it occurred for in this time frame. 2001, Margarita Martinez is the first woman of color and first Latina woman elected as a synodical bishop in the ELCA. 2004, Phyllis Anderson is the first woman of European descent to serve as a president of an ELCA seminary. 2009, Dolores McKay is the first woman of Middle Eastern descent ordained. And in 2013, Elizabeth Eaton is the first woman of European descent elected as the presiding bishop of the ELCA. And Eaton was reelected on the first ballot in 2019. 2018, Patricia Davenport is the first woman of African descent elected as a bishop in the ELCA. Let me share with you just some stats that I have from our ELCA.org website. In 1975, there were 32 women pastors in the predecessor bodies of the ELCA. In 2015, there are 4,552 women pastors in the ELCA. Now, I think it's so important for us to say that this breaking down of the barrier of men-only pastors is so important for the life of the church. New and fresh voices have been brought to bear for the life of this church. And I give thanks that I've not known a day in ministry where women have not been full partners. And while progress has been made, much more is required. Here are some disturbing realities. Men are more likely to be lead pastors, while women are more likely to be associate pastors. As of 2016, only 119 out of 145 churches in the Lutheran World Federation ordain women. As of 2016, women pastors made 86% of what their male counterparts made. 32% of female pastors experienced sexual harassment, while only 6.5% of men pastors experienced sexual harassment. Women of color face a disproportionate wait time for their first calls in comparison to their white counterparts. I think our legacy, and this is clear, is our daughters and our granddaughters now live in a church that is dedicated to welcoming women as full partners and equals, thanks to Elizabeth Platts. In this moment, I'd like to say what an honor it is for me to work with Pastor Patricia Shaw, who is our visitation pastor, without whose ministry there's no way that I could find a way of seeing all the people that need to be seen. I'm grateful for her partnership with me in the life of this church. So those are some really important people, and if any of those people excite you, don't be afraid to be in touch with your library and read more about these people. They are fantastic souls, because these three people have really shaped and formed the church that we have right now, and the church that we're looking at moving forward with into the future. And that will really be my next bit of information, is talking about the reality of what's coming next. Now, I don't have a crystal ball, but this is a topic that I have been studying and researching for the last 10 years. And so I look forward to sharing some of my thoughts of what might happen in the life of the church moving forward. I'm so glad that you've spent this time with me talking about these wonderful people of faith. I want to remind you once again that tomorrow we'll be principally speaking with Dr. Chris Meyer. New content Monday through Friday is always available 4:30. And I want to remind all of you of the Home Communion with Pastor Arthur and Jennifer Peace, live 4:30 only on Saturday. Everyone needs the sacrament. I want to encourage you to come there at least once a month and receive the sacrament. As always, be safe and be well. And remember, God loves you, and so do I.